You talk about testimony, that's testimony. People were not really trying to do a good job.
No, I'll give you the
understood. The attitude of people, because it did make sense. We had a job to do, we were told to do this much, and I thought, well, if we all there, we would get done by a certain time and we would be fine. But they were not threatening, but close to it. Back in those days, I was a bit encouraged, and so they were a little fearful from me. But the point was, I didn't like their attitude towards them. I didn't like their attitude towards me, but I saw them. They gave me a very bad taste in my mouth. I'll be honest with you, for union workers. But I thought, okay, they're getting paid. It's all about seniority, it's all about the time, you get a break, you get a stop right at the intersection. All those things. Welcome on individuals to truly do their best, and they were taking advantage of that. He lays in reductions of the cost of the project, and sort of cut it the right time the project could have gotten done. So instead of doing something a little bit more, I was excited that I had the job, I was going to pay above average wages for being in the union. But I thought to myself, why aren't these individuals going to rip off the attitude that permeated them? Well, the same attitude friends might have had in Stillman, but they could sleep on a broom on the night shift. Like, how long do you need to keep a job sleeping on a broom instead of just getting to the group? It might not be a prestigious job that they're going to pay $20 an hour back in those days, and with benefits. And I thought, you guys are doing very well in like the 70s. So it was a lot of money back then.
Pay for the work you're doing. unit and what you're getting for it. Remember, we brought all of it to maintain submission. And submission is husband to wife, wife to husband, child to parents, parents to children. And here we're seeing the responsibility of a spirit-filled life as submission to those who are open and workforce and workplace. And again, what's being asked of us today, in America at least, is nowhere near the atrocities and the pressure that might come. It's been a woman or a child that was a story, even male, but was a slave in those days. Point being, God's grace is sufficient to bring us through and to help us bring to pass in our life these kinds of exhortations.
What the Paul was saying, just because you may think slavery is wrong for me, you don't bring to a student of the day's work for a student day. You don't do that. You have to function as if that person is working for you for the Lord. And conduct a second part of
it. Right. The Lord will watch you, and he's watching your body.
Standards be given out outside. Academy. Tuition costs are very competitive, www.blackmountain.org and click on the link, and we will take care of the rest. If you enjoy the music, if you enjoy the teaching, if you enjoy the preaching, if you believe that you receive your spiritual nourishment from being the preacher's head, then come join the thousands from all over the world that can now say, I am a Family Worship Center Media Church member. We'll read out and we welcome you into the family here at Family Worship Center. I urge you.
Fabric of our nation is being torn apart by unseen forces in America through television and social media. In a powerful book, Rape of a Nation, evangelist Jimmy Swaggart unveils the making of the beginnings of society and their intentions for our nation. We are at a crucial point in history. This book will provide a great understanding of the dark powers that are and how to influence Rape of the Nations and our nation. To purchase Rape of the Nation, go to JohnJSN.com.
but it's really still continuing to pick up. They're not stopping, even though the world is shrinking. So, interestingly enough, though, the Biden administration said that what happened there, it didn't come across the breath in line with Biden. They didn't cross, they didn't lose, they didn't go too far. So it might be that the United States recognized which you stated that, yeah, this is a result of what's happening, but did Israel go and this just caused this to happen with 50 people died in Israel? No. But we did. Our world is right now, once again, talking about something that is exponential, but it's what we want to say.
I hope that you could prove that there was a step in there that caused the outbreak of fire. That would prove what we didn't say to be the case, although the Israeli intelligence. Maybe I'll use the term Jeff in the hack. But once again, the Hamas is not going to stop their efforts to destroy Israel, even if they're given a tank. They've been given continental two-state solution. And those nations that claim the two-state solution has been a solution are only doing so to be preserving their borders from tyranny. Not because there's a logical conclusion that true peace can be evolved. They know that the individual would suffer in the
market. You know, and one more time, let's kind of answer this question, and of course it is a scriptural answer we give. The question why? Why does the world, the majority of the world, and this is true, the majority of the world and the people in the world are not in favor of it. Either they don't care about nor do they think about Israel. Those that do, which is still defined. Where do we find those who tend to support and really love Israel most? We find that in the Christian community. Even in the Jewish community here in the United States, albeit they're very steadily, but we see even in the Jewish community here in the United States that they are opposed to many things that the state of Israel tends to do. They're not in favor of what the state of Israel does. They seem to be against it. These are some of the wealthiest people in this country. Some of the most powerful people. They even forget that. Just people in that, it would be that, I guess, lineage of that sin. But in the Christian community, we do find, I believe, a true, genuine love for Israel. So, I guess it's a hard question. Why does so much of the world hate Israel, but then at the same time you can say, why do so many Christians love and support Israel?
I think the answer is very obvious to me. The one is born again. There is a lot of discussion, of course, with God loves.
You're born again.
And you're truly born again. The love you love is Israel. Obviously. I know many quote him, many boast to him. I've read his literature. I don't think he understands the Bible. I know a lot of folks would push back and say, wait a minute, you're great on Augustine?
Well, he was back. I know. Time for him to make
it. But so much has been taken from him, even more than the scripture. See, one of the challenges the church faced for years, even reformers, they based a lot of their evidence of interpretation on the church fathers instead of the word of God. So they were looking at somebody else's interpretation.
Augustine was a prophet.
But seriously, people have connected to the institutes where you got that from Justin Martyr, and you find evidence of that in letters that were come from him and others about this idea that Israel was a spot the church. Others brought that concept in as well, origin, and that was obviously began teaching, and then others of the reform leaders, even such as Calvin. And even Oracle, for instance,
that he would still adopt that today, this idea of replacement theology, you know, that acts as if the church is replaced. Israel, so we read the Bible, you have to, whenever you see Israel, especially in the New Testament, you have to look at the Romans. It's but I'm talking about the church. I don't believe the church is replaced. I believe it's not that is a disconnection, but it does.
So, and people get to talk to you,
it will essentially be fulfilled. See the rapture of the church and the proceedings that happen after that, but I find it's very evident in scripture. Once the church takes place, the resurrection of the church, catching you wish.
Which is entertaining now, for all we know.
The intention of perfect time. Obviously, in every regard. It's great. And I don't see how you can read any, they call it popular literature, but how you can read any prophetic wishes of the Bible and not see that clearly. But again, the reason the world hates Israel
is because the world hates God. They don't know God. There's an enmity between God and humanity. So man has ever been, through superstition and other means, trying to serve other gods or create their own gods, or really they're worshiping Satan, to whom the God of this world has blinded the mind of them that believe not. So creation wasn't sufficient for them to accept God because it's not. It reveals that there is a God which would lead one to seek out a God, the true God. At the same time, the conscience. But the conscience can be unfortunately seared, so it can also be a skewed element to draw someone to Christ. But we've read this before, it's supposed to be in Psalm 83. It says in verse 1, keep not thy silence, O God, hold not thy peace, and be not still, O God. For will my enemies make a small company and make me lifted up to heaven? If crafty counsel against my people and soul began to tell you, they've said, come, let us cut them off from the image. Name Israel and be the Lord of remembrance. Cut off Catherine and remove any living for them to have a people. Peace, not a family. They have no disagreement, but their leaders, especially those on the very prominent 20th century, all the debate will be clear. It's necessary to remove Israel, to remove the Jewish people. Jihad was the means by doing that. Islamic leaders of the 20th century all talked about the resurgence and the reestablishment of the caliphate in the world with the intent of spreading Israel on the Shiite side. Islamic faith have become a and as an individual and as a sort of and the one that will take all of them, the president that was just killed, they all talked about death to Israel, death to America. And it's not just death to the national element of it. It's the disruption and eradication of the people. From the river to the sea, that is the question and prayer between people to a monarch and cultists by the country's students. All are not going to be men. Many of us here, it shall have been too many of them. But one of them, but the two of them, but the founder of the Muslim Brotherhood, it's the one called Allah. But the Islamic world, the Jerusalem, the prayer for words, the Hajj, the Arabs, the Sunni, and their relatives, Yasser Arafat, maternally related to Hajime Al-Mutari. Salman al-Banah is married to Saudi Ramadan. All the individuals were instrumental in taking the messaging of the Islamic jihadist message to our universities, but subversively through integrating and assimilation until they gave strength and opportunity to now present their thoughts. We're seeing the outbreak of what was planned decades of freedom.
A lot of students on these college campuses that, I mean, when you look at it, they've been radicalized.
Yeah.
They are radicalized. Not in a good way whatsoever. And I've said it before, it's strong, but I really feel this is true. So what we've seen on these college campuses, and really all throughout, if they have the opportunity, they right now, they are bringing out what we saw.
Okay.
All throughout the world. The time leading up to the Holocaust and against the concentration camps were utilized. But they would go through the streets, they would round up every Jew they could find. They'd take everything that they own, that they have, including their own. That's what they would do now. And the hate comes from the pit of hell, first of all. They are inspired by, if not some, possessed by, the powers of darkness. Talk about these people. They would act and they would do exactly what they've done under British Germany and really off the ground in Europe to the 1930s leading up to the 1990s. It would happen. That hate is the same. So, ladies and gentlemen, when we see all this, it's not just, oh, they've got the right or it's freedom of speech. It goes a little beyond that. That's why immediately, you know, very early on, I was like, well, you know, everybody should have that right.
Most folks don't know this, but it's not a big come to create Jews and Gentiles coming together. That there's no more necessity for a national Israel in the future. No, that will be the case in the future, but the fact that there is a remnant of the Jewish people, the Hebrews, whatever you want to call them, is a sign of the new covenant being in effect. So if Satan can eliminate the Jews, that removes the new covenant. Let me read scriptures to prove what I'm saying in Jeremiah chapter 31. Starting in verse 35, this is God's signature to the new covenant contract. We can read about that, verses 31 to 34. But he says this, verse 35. A sense of the Lord, who gives the sun for light by day, the orbits of the moon, the stars for light by night, and plots the waves that are born, or if boasts is his name. That is the signature verse. Anyone who has studied Hebrew or Old Testament theology knows there are handfuls of scriptures like this. That's the Lord saying, I sign this. Now, it was ratified and signed in the blood of Jesus Christ when it was fulfilled. If those ordinances, what ordinances? The ordinances he was just talking about. Depart from before me, says the Lord. Then the seed of Israel shall cease from being an nation before me forever. Thus says the Lord, if heaven and earth can be measured, which is why we don't want to try to guess the length of the years of the earth. This is a joke. I'm going to be very strong about this. But what Mr. Ken Ham has done with the creation scientists, which is following Henry Morey and these others, with their idea that the earth is only 6,000 or 7,000 years old, that's all nonsense. We can go into that debate, because that's all they end up doing, is debating that issue. The fact is, we don't know, and we shouldn't even try to find out according to these scriptures. If those ordinances from the Department of Remembrance that the seed of Israel shall also cease from being a nation before me, thus says the Lord, if heaven above can be measured, and the foundations of the earth searched out beneath, I will also cast off all the seed of Israel for all they have done, says the Lord. The signature of the Lord on the new covenant, and also the very creation that he has made as far as the universe and the earth, are equated to Israel's existence. If either of those can be found out or destroyed, then Israel would be lost, hence the new covenant will no longer be enforced. It is necessary, Paul brings that up in Romans chapters 9 through 11, for a remnant of Israel to be there and remain. You and I, in an interesting part, are a remnant, because although we are true born again believers in Christ Jesus, our progeny is of the national Israel that once existed and will once again exist. Their name will remain forever, said the Lord, Isaiah 66:20. That's why we know the Jews, is because God has a future plan for them. But even now, we can see, although it is the times of the Gentiles, it's not the time for national Israel. That's why they're not going to have peace in Jerusalem. That's why there'll be no peace in Jerusalem until the Prince of Peace comes back at the end of the Great Tribulation period. At the end of the 7 years of the tribulation, he will return at the Battle of Armageddon, when the world is mounting an attack in the Valley of Megiddo to come against Jerusalem, and they will fail because Jesus Christ himself will come and stop the war.
Speaking of which, the poem which God has written his name, is it?
Second Chronicles 6:6.
That's right. They desire not only the destruction of people, but we have to look too as the promise that God made, the covenant really that God made with Abraham, included the land of Israel, the land covenant. They being those that hate God and were opposed. Really, we could talk and say it this way, that Satan, he desires people of Israel, the Jews, to be destroyed, and he desires the land of Israel, specifically Jerusalem.
And why does he want Jerusalem?
Because that is the eternal throne. That's the eternal seat.
So he wants to reign from Jerusalem, Satan, doesn't he?
Yes, he surely does. That's why he wants land. That's why the Antichrist will be so driven, so consumed. Now, he'll be, for a period of time, his attention will be drawn away, but he will come right back to his two-pronged goal, his dual mandate that the evil one has given him, which is destroy, cut off every Jew, cut them off from being a nation, and take the land, specifically Jerusalem. That's it. That's why. It's because the one that will fuel him, Satan, desires both of those things to take place for the very reasons that you just talked about. Israel was, is, and will continue to be the apple of God's eye. That's it. And we see, as much as there has been strife and turmoil,
say they asked for it, but they were given an opportunity. Israel was given an opportunity to have eternal peace when they were offered the Lord Jesus Christ. Now, the future mentions that to come. That's going to be phenomenal for several reasons. But one phenomenal reason regarding that time is because Israel will finally look at, see, and accept the Lord Jesus Christ as their Messiah.
And as a nation.
As a nation, that's right. Now, there were individuals, you're right, that when he came the first time, this time, next time, yeah. Second time. When he's coming back from King of Kings and Lord of Lords, fairest of 10,000, they're going to see him. And they're going to recognize, because they're going to see the nail prints in his hand. They're going to see in his side. They're going to ask him, where did you receive it? To their Messiah, they'll ask him. He's going to give that answer. It's so strong and so true. I was wounded in the house of my friends. And what a time, what day that is going to be. But between all of what we've seen in 2,000 years of diaspora, where they were scattered all over the world.
Yeah.
I mean, incredible when you think about it. All over the world. In 1948, to be brought back, to be regathered in the land, not in Uganda or not in some place in South America, but in the land of Israel. Only God. And the Word of God has told us that was going to happen. Only God could do that, but we see his hand to them. As soon as they were regathered, as soon as they became a nation in 1948, they were immediately attacked. There was an immediate war.
The beginning of Psalm 83, I don't think there's any wars made, so-called prophetic teachers. It is a series of wars and an attitude that permeates with the day.
October the 7th, this is what it is.
Another break of wood. Fulfillment, I believe.
I mean, but when you look at it, the hand of God on the Arab Israel, when you look at it in Yom Kippur, the sixth day, you just start looking at it all through the 80s. I mean, it's clearly been the hand of God protecting his people, even though they not accept the Lord Jesus Christ as nationally speaking to Messiah. Still, God, he is the holy and faithful one of Israel. He made his promise. He's going to keep.
He said, for my name's sake,
my name,
I brought them back.
My
he was 36. And for his name's sake, he was fulfilled the promise of the covenant that he made with Abraham. He is faithful. And that's why we can trust him, because he is faithful to all of our needs.
That's it. That's it. My mind. We're out of time. It.
Thank you for joining us on Inside Today. Join us again tomorrow. We'll be back with more. In the meantime, stay tuned for more programming. Special guest Tommy Bate will be on with Donnie on the Francis and Friends Show. If preceded, I'm following this program, but then also be here tonight. Plus, maybe we'll be preaching for us, glad we found the worship time. So join us if you're in the area or tune in for this service. Money will be blessed. Thank you. Special offer for you. A grandfather will, of course, a commentary on every single book.
some 10 songs that I'll come up to you that you won't play it one time and give it a shot. You play it over and over and over again. I believe each and every song is anointed with the Holy Spirit. And if that is the case, I promise you this, this will be a blessing to you. There's something about nature that is powerful. The longest book in the Bible, the Book of Psalms, is given over altogether to music, to worship, to worship the Lord. If you don't have this, you need to get it. And I'll promise you, won't be disappointed. Just $18. And like I said, you'll play it over and over and over again. Now, go to the phone, make the call, get this, and you'll say to the swagger, I'm glad that I did.
It's important for all Christians to recognize false doctrine. On the teaching DVD, The Truth About Catholicism, you will learn of various areas where Catholicism is not in agreement with the Bible. Some of these Catholic doctrines include the adoration of Mary, infant baptism, purgatory, and our Catholic saints. To purchase the DVD, Truth About Catholicism, go to shopjsm.org.
Doug Smyer, I want to invite everyone in the Lubbock, South Dakota area to come and be with me June the 7th through the 9th. I'm going to be in Lubbock at New Old Worship Center Friday night at 7 o'clock, Saturday night at 6 o'clock, and Sunday morning at 10:30 a.m. Once again, that's June the 7th through the 9th, New Old Worship Center, Lubbock, South Dakota. For more information, the phone number's on the screen, the address is on the screen, or you can go to my website, DonnieSmyer.org. Adam and Eve were created in the image and likeness of God. Their failure to heed God's commandment resulted in the loss of their spiritual lives. In this book, evangelist Teresa Hahn explains original sin, its deadly consequences, and its only remedy, Jesus Christ and the crucified. Readers will sense the love of God has for mankind, a love so strong that plan was in place to bring them back. To purchase The Fall of Man, go to shopjsm.org.
Combined into one youth camp, will be run by Crossfire.
During that week that we set aside the middle week of every month to come to you, if you are not able to help us, that happens. We understand that. If you are able to help us now, we are
Yes, Lord.
Temple, you can read that in Mark 11:16, as well as household utensils.
the English word comes from the Latin word sum, which refers to a receptacle that covers and contains. Thus, the word refers, the word comes, to refer to an instrument whereby something is accomplished. In this case, it refers to a chosen instrument of God. The husband is what the body will convert. The tree is the instrument of God, as well as the husband is the child of God, to be used by him for his glorious benefit. And say, then, as we heirs together of the grace of life, this remains reminding the husband that this is the grace afforded to you as the Lord. Saying I, that when God died, he died just as much for her as he died for you, and you are never to forget that God looks down and looks at the will of the not on equal standing, that your prayers be not hindered. The whole idea of this remains that if there's mistreatment of the part of the husband to the wife, then that could well be one reason why prayers of the husband are hindered. It is very simple. If you're not, it doesn't, whether it's a marriage situation, anything, God's word has given us the scripture of life. And we, in any area, are not following the scripture. We will hinder our prayers. Not saying that no prayer will ever end, but it will be much less of pure joy. Say, I'm a deep evil. Spouses, or mother, father, whoever, section of them should run much deeper than those outside of the family. That's one thing that the pinnacle needs to be deeper hearted toward your spouse. That's the whole idea of that. Or you can say it this way, we are to be merciful as my Heavenly Father has been merciful to us. I think that's the best way to say it. Be courteous, that just needs to be friendly, needs to be toward your spouse. You're made to do both, to be doing everything in their power to make the spouse to life as easy as possible. We all think that the wife fails and that the husband fails and that.
Thank you for being on.
Those things, but that's what we should strive to do. All right, we'll pick up the next time. First number nine. Father, come before in the name of your Son, Jesus. We thank you for the opportunity of sharing your word. And we pray, Lord, that we brought forth today's blessing to the viewer. And we pray that fruit will come from it. And as we know, we bring the needs of the people for you. And we ask those needs to be met in Jesus' name. Phone lines are open. 800-342-8430. 800-342-8430. If you have a question or comment or email on air at
Container is full and heavy.
Facebook.com/friends. All right, we're back. What a question of the day is a really interesting question. What was the song Stone included in the King James Version? I can only remember, man, I think maybe it passed the Bible period because it's been from the Hebrew text, so it's not just the King James, it's in all versions of the Bible, whether it's a literal word for word or whether it's a terrible I can only remember maybe in my lifetime, maybe quite, it was included in a nice term. Well, now, you have Doctor in front of your name, and you are a product of the seminary. So we're going to lay this on your lap to begin with, right?
Well, you're holding to a name. You know, the greatest sermon ever heard preached from the first Bible was Dr. Delmar Gwine. Do you remember that?
Yes, I do.
Delmar Gwine was president of Southwestern for 3 years. Prior to that, he was a missionary in Malaysia. But he came to the campus once and preached that one day.
Now the bacon, bacon.
You can contrast the two books, and I would encourage all this is on with two different directions. That was the text. And so I'm going to encourage you to consider getting that and reading it from the commentary and getting more information that way. Jackie from Illinois is our...
Part of the problem with people during the day of surprise was they weren't expecting the king. They wanted a Messiah who would deliver them from the Roman Empire. And they would not accept a partner.
Yeah.
Same principle as the shepherd.
They wanted a conquering king. They did not want a suffering savior.
Yeah.
I love books. It's all none of us anybody out there because cannot read it as a narrative. I remember we had to sudden death in our church, and I'm just praying. The man was very good to me. He did work on fencing and his wife. They were very solid Christians, and I was praying, Lord, for a bunch of Christians that I use. And the Spirit of the Lord moved on me. A verse from Psalm of Solomon came out and said, his legs are like those of sockets of gold. And I remember praying, and I said, Lord, that's about the strangest scripture I've ever heard. He said, no. He said, you tell her I can carry any situation. He said, Psalm of Solomon is talking about me. My legs are like newly barley, sockets of gold. And all of my divinity, even my divinity sockets of gold, my legs are like newly. And I'm telling you, I did that with the Lord. In the Spirit of God, I'm not certain talking about them. My legs are like tumors of barley. You can feel the comfort of God. Never use that again before. Another scripture where it says that Max Shula said, well, what do you think about this? That this is what she said. He said, why? It's what it's written. It's only one of them that you're in the body at the same time. That is the love of God that is plain. And when I read the Song of Solomon, you cannot read it as a narrative. Every verse has its own revelation. Every section has its own revelation. And I did the same thing. First time I heard the Song of Solomon, when I was 52 years ago, when I started the ministry, I forgot to read the Bible. I got the Song of Solomon, and I said, I love you, Lord. This is the weirdest book I've ever read. And I said, this is for somebody else. That's not for me. I'll just read it because I have to, and then I'll skip over it. And then I went to a pastor's seminar in Florida, and a man got up and said, I know some of you have wondered about the Song of Solomon, and said, it's in there to help strengthen our marriage and stuff. Because I read a lot of the Bible. And I married to a woman from Auckland County, Kentucky, up in the mountains. And I said, in my mind, I said, no, I don't think that's going to work for me. I'm not going to tell my wife. Her hair looks like a flock of goats. And, it looks like the Tower of David. I said, this is not right. And one day, I can't even believe, one day, the revelation came to me through the Spirit when I was praying. And it was like, this is the Song of Solomon. You know, this is the woman had a pact with him in his eyes. I said, dreamer, come get by it. All of its name, but none of them had his heart. So Solomon round 50 miles away to the land of Shur. And he said, I'm going to find you somebody who wants my heart. Not what I've got, my possessions. And it's so opposite to what people are looking for in Christ today. They want the kingly portion of Christ before they want the shepherd portion. But God started revealing to me, oh my goodness, every line had something. Because he said, I'm not sure if I'm going to be able to do that.
Grandma said, give me another Bible, King James.
Everything. And if you know everything, then you show me how to fight this behavior. And
Chief Village Wear.
Thank you. abortion central in the last couple of years. The first one is called the right to life. Every Christian conservative needs this. We need to watch it and understand what the Bible says about the subject of abortion. The second, say the word. At last, the upstream of the plan. Each one of these messages, of course, are anointed by the Holy Spirit and will be able to continue to hear this. Every single one of you that ordered this $15 is $40 for all three of these particular combos. However, we will throw in a very special bonus. Ron Payne's CD, I found the limit in my bag. We'll look for a call on the right.
Temple will be rebuilt, called the Millennial Temple, and when worship will go on there, and so everything will be moved.
provides a face to this earth. And it would be the New Jerusalem. Any other comments, gentlemen, on that? If you would like to add to that, I hope that answers the question.
Yeah, a little confused, though.
Okay.
And then the new earth will be in Jerusalem.
Well, they're Jerusalem will be the center of God. That will be the capital of the world life. And of that. And the world. There will still be entities in the world that we don't know what names will be. There will still be powers. And this is for those that are not in their glorified body. And so the two types of people that will be on the earth during that time. The glorified saints. And then those that are in their natural body. And the natural body people are those that are left on the earth at the second coming of Jesus Christ. And so they will be spread far flung all over the globe. And like I said, I don't know if countries and the borders will be the exact same as today. The Bible doesn't give us indication one way or the other of that. And I don't know if there'll still be different languages. My personal opinion is that we'll have, even those in the natural body, somehow will be given the ability to communicate. I don't see that language being a barrier on this earth. We don't know that, and so I don't want anybody speculating on all that. It's just me thinking. But the world's attention will be focused on Jerusalem.
Revelation 21 and 22, and then the newer.
And if you read those two chapters in Revelation, that will help.
Okay, well, I feel a little baffled, though. So this new heaven and new earth, the Father will be present.
Oh, sure, and the Son and the Holy Spirit
will be in the new heaven and new earth.
It's coming down here, and we know that God is moving his kingdom from heaven to this earth.
That was what I was confused about. Can I ask one more?
Sure, thing? Yes, ma'am.
Okay. Why do you say there's no reference? Well, I guess there is.
This is your friend was committing an act of what we would call willful sin. They knew that what they were putting out on that paper was not right, and they did it to deceive someone in order to gain something. And if she claims to be a Christian, she's got problems. And you're not wrong in your stretch of the imagination. You're not a word about it. You're not a publisher. You did not touch her. Judge is when you look at it. When you try to judge, most of them, some of them, we don't know the person. We don't know the picture that I'm going to have to be. We can't much judge fruit. We actually can't judge. The Bible is very clear.
Most people refer to it as several verses. Does John say you're not open to anything?
But that's not what you have to do.
The Bible talks about things that you can make right to them. And as you said, we did fruit behavior. You better now be working on your bar. Things that have not been wrong. And you should prepare your refrigerator or your groceries for making judgments all the time. Condemnation.
We cannot let up many judgments. Every single thing we do have judgments based on the information that we have at that moment. Sometimes our judgment is wrong, but it's based on the information we have, and we get more information and we correct it.
There's probably two places to define it: the word judge and judgment. One is an evaluation, the other one is the spine of advisement. Judges today make the decision of that final advisement. That's not what the church does. That's not a judge.
Right.
I was simply evaluating that evidence and fruit, so to speak. The Bible does still have the elders judge. What does that mean? It means you got to evaluate and observe. Right at home.
In every situation, I'm capable of putting one in the air. Okay?
Yes.
You're on air.
Okay, thank you. I have sort of before I say on the solid supplements, I see that as one of the greatest young stories in the world. I know a love story for you. He gave me his all for the human for me. And his other version is I don't have to comment on all of his many family that is not the story. And I didn't comment on that, but I forgot a few bits, but I'd love to call about how crazy evil that he's calling out from how he delicious for many of them, but that's kind of great info.
Influence upon them, or family pressures, or community pressures. There are chicken and raisins. But none of it matters. What matters is, what does God say? We know that God is not the author of that. God created government. Second, we know that God does not approve of transgenderism, same-sex, and abortion. He doesn't approve of that. And a person who calls himself a Christian, and yet they align themselves with candidates, politicians, and political parties that not only advocate those things, but are openly in the language of that platform hostile toward Christians. The two are together. Except that they agree, come back to any of us are agreeing that how the two are together. And so these people are going to hear me out because it is what they don't want to hear. We let them vote for a party or a platform or a candidate that it is endorsing those things contrary to the word of God. They are condoning those sins. Number two, they're entering in those sins. Number three, that's the thing I've known before that I know. And, you know, and when you deal with people like that, sometimes you can't deal with them. They're not going to change. You can call them, but you just keep saying what I'm saying. And keep saying what I'm saying. And keep saying what I'm saying. And hold stubborn. Allow the Holy Spirit to open their eyes. Or Jeremy K. That's why it's important for us that to confirm that we are vote, that every single vote doesn't count. Every single vote counts in every single election, whether it's for school board or whether it's for president and the state. But thank you for calling on that. I appreciate your time. Please get your money, first John 5:16, first John 7. Any that wants to fix for another sin, and which is not unto death, no man, and he shall give it in life, but no sin, not unto death. There is a sin unto death, that you must say that he shall pray for it. Let me just read, let's go back to the beginning, and let's read the notes in the next Bible study. By looking at him and seeing his brothers in the sin, which is not unto death, which refers to direction, and the cross done in us. Let me pause that. Let me everything. Your book of limited messages, when I mean, we read the Old Testament Paul's, it talked about sins of ignorance. And what it's meaning here in 1 John is that their ignorance, if not in regard, it's the rest of the verse will bear out against the cross. The meaning of Christ came to people to be here. And really, all of this contains and how did you deal with the sin? I think a lot of this goes to new believers. New believers are doing things that they're not aware in their new walk with the Lord that they're doing is contrary to the word of God. That's why I personally they said there is a sin unto death. And what is that sin unto death? Well, that is the sin of turning your back on Christ and being crucified. Rejecting the means of salvation and accepting another means. You're not studying the Colossians right now. Colossians, the Colossian church. Well, it's being ripped apart by three things. Number one, says the bones of the church trying to please God. That's not the knowledge of this. First, we're talking about personal pleasures. There's the it's tremendous time to find through God, according to man-made rules and regulations, or your own rules and regulations. got a system and a nasty system. They all keep the one number denominator. But they all, they go against God's prescribed order. And that is a sin unto death. Now, some came back in the church of Colossae. I'm just going to about to say, hopefully all of them did. But it had to be serious enough for a pastor, the pastor, the founder of the church, to let Paul know that he did not ever visit. We've got a problem here. And it's this. And so these were sins that could lead to a sin unto death. Any thoughts?
I mean, that's just to show that there should be relationships between Christians. If you are a new Christian, honestly, you should seek advice from old Christians. I believe Paul would even call that to Timothy, the older ladies, helping out the young ladies and how they should perform their duties. And what I mean by that is, if a man see his brother sin, he shall ask and give them life. In other words, help them. Now show him, hey, you didn't know about this. Let me tell you scripturally how this is a sin against
God. That's the way to do it. Not say, hey, quit doing that, you're wrong, you're good. No, they don't know. They're babes in Christ. That's what they need to be. So you need to set them down, show them the Word of God. This is not what you should be doing. And then ask them to seek the Lord. That's an excellent point. Look, Ina from Indiana, you're on the air.
Good morning.
Good morning, ma'am. Decay. And we won't have a full benefit
about the new covenant until we're going to glorify it today. Next. God is sovereign, even above his word, which means we cannot use his word against him. In other words, next, there are sometimes I believe that God's wisdom, he chooses not to heal. Now, what do you mean by that? Well, let's put it, I have a perfect example because it's perfect, not to me, but someone observed that got answer. Love the Lord, serve the Lord, spirit filled, excellent, for many years, kept down cancer. This woman once knew the power. You got the minute you got that doctor's report and it was serious. You don't have much time. You need to put your affairs in order. She went out to that little church that she had walked out of years ago, walked up after service and said, "Go and move on." And they prayed for her. God healed her. She came back to church for the first time in the day. I offered it. But while later, several months later, that cancer came up. And when Mother Dad found out, yes, we got to get, we got to pray. And the Lord came to my dad and said, "No." He looked out for her. And he, she needs to get her, make her heart right. Dad was perplexed by that. The Lord said, "It looked better. They could heal her. Let her walk away and lose her stuff.
Why did this lame man not get healed by Jesus himself? I don't know. Even today, it's now available online. Go to the phones from Crack Addict to CEO.
dedication and in relationship with the Lord. Dr. Gray?
You know, for me, you and I would be the same up on top of this fight. The money went there for about 2 or 3 years. The company is very important. My dad went on top of that. It really got to do it. He became a preacher. He touched a lot of lives. Your dad, you know your dad signed up to a stop right there? Told me that he was in the revivals, and the revival got extended, and he just couldn't find a place to stop and go. You know, all that's Western. But Jerry Lincoln didn't want to do that, so he put up college. But Bible college is really important, but you can study on your own and learn a whole lot and know the Lord by lots of books and study there.
That's your best way, and I agree that it's about what's your requirement at. But what is a requirement? You have to be students. And I don't mean a student in a classroom. You have to be a student of the Word of God. You have to study in order to show yourself approved.
That study also involves study of men of God,
yes,
who God has given an anointing to open and explain the Word in books, commentaries, whatever the case. My dad, we got a room over here in the office. He moved out his whole life from the house. And if you go in and open up those books, you'll find underlined, you'll find notes that he handwrote on the side, questions that he wrote. And you'll just see a deep study. And he studied even books that he would not agree with theologically on certain aspects, and they did not agree with him theologically, and primarily Christian, the Pentecostal method. But yet, he opened himself up to a wide variety. The reason that he wanted to know, he wanted to learn, but he also wanted to know what the era was. You know, Daddy?
Absolutely, I would love to lose some Esther and a half of Bible college, but I've studied that book.
Yeah.
I started out with Thompson Chain Reference Bible. Then for a while you used Dave. Now you use your dad's Bible as a book. And you've got to study. You have to know. It's got to be a real view before you can minister, get to the
right
book.
Just like Gary Warren said, you have to call first.
Yeah.
And once you're called, then you should have a hunger for the Word of God. I came from a very disciplined home. Everybody I was raised in the Bible. But the characters in the Bible were talked about as if they were alive right there in the house. We knew the names of them, you know, the illustration used. I got my credit because I went to Emory University, because we come from a very strict Pentecostal system, and they couldn't understand how I could go to Emory University, but I felt the call of the Lord to do that. So I got a bachelor's and master's in education, but I never laid my Bible down.
Yeah,
ever.
And the book again is an individual mix of about that. If God is dealing with you about ministry, he'll open that door. And it can be little by little by little. But no, the answer is, Diana, I'm from Texas. You're over there.
Good morning,
ma'am.
Yeah. But the Lord told me just because you're saying it's funny, you're not asking questions.
should be done and the world problems.
I think that we can't be so legalistic that we don't recognize that sometimes in a moment of shock over something that we may say something that we think we make right. I think the Lord understands that. I think that the name of the Lord is to be looked at as the most holy of all things. And we need to be very careful how we throw that name around and how we use that name around, how we use that name. Tommy,
so would you say? I stress the same way my brother over here said. I just think people need bad influence. And it becomes, I know very good people that use terms that I would never use, that using the Lord's name, they say Jesus, you know, in law, okay, that's the problem. Jesus, I'm glad to see you're here, you know, they want to call him a Lord. I think we all need to improve, all of us. I mean, I'm sure it's your strength.
Yeah.
Does that help you,
Diane?
You may not be able to,
I don't know the way to say it. I don't know what's happening with the logic, first of all.
When I turn on television, it's not speaking in the stack out of the eyes and in the top of the neck. But at the same time, I'm not going to sit there and let certain language just be out over and over and over. I'm not after that. I don't really care for that. But I don't go into a connection with watching something, and I hear something, you know, I don't throw a fit because understand these are not Christians. You know, it's like flying light in the airport. I mean, you hear everything, but it's not. Well, I don't get, you know, I don't go jump on people because they're sinners. I don't know what they're talking about. I just, what I'm trying to do is live my life. Lord, I'm not doing that. And when it came to my kids, I monitor what they watch, what they listen to. We did that, and I don't regret one moment of that. And I think the fact that I'm over here saved and loving the Lord and serving the Lord and active in the churches, very much so, I think we did a good job on that. So, you're just going to have to go by the leading of the Spirit. I mean, I'm going to point out population. Let's talk about television. We went to three today. Both of those years I was a pastor. They were like a basketball. And sometimes I would come to my house and I would see something on television with the Lord to be watching. And you sat there and maybe something bad is being said. Or bad news portrayed, but I didn't just walk through the room. I stopped there and I said, well, what are you doing? Watching? I said, I have a life. I didn't have a life that too well. But I took charge of the room and said, we will watch it with Paul. I think parents didn't do it, but frankly, I think I remember one time explaining to my sons this. I said, if you feel like a person of the world coming to the house, first, accepted, or it would be studied. No, we don't allow cursing in our house. You must leave this house if you don't talk that way. That's what I would do. And I probably would have had to send somebody down the road. Why should we let television come into our house
about the children that I'm touching.
Yeah.
Anything else coming up? Thank you, thank you. If you want to make a Michael certificate, it is 1 John 3:14. Does the brethren need other believers, or is it talking about the one? Let's just repeat it. 1 John 3:14. We know we have passed from death unto life because we love the brethren. He who loves not his brethren abides in death. The brethren is a biblical term for other believers. We are to have, it's plainly telling us here that we have an obligation for the household of faith that's different than the world. And the way that we talk to them, and the way that we treat them, and different things like that, they are family. In Christ, that's why we're called brothers and sisters in the Lord. We are part of the body of Christ. And family is such, you know, I've got to treat my kids a good way. They're mine, the flesh of my flesh, the blood of my blood. But as a Christian of Christians, they are part of the family of God. And it's a really blessed being there. Any other comments on that?
It almost, I don't know if I'm reading something out of your comment, it almost sounds like the question of it's if they're not in the church, or again, I won't be able to have to make me so loving to work.
Well, no, well, we're all, we show Mark Jesus as a loved one for another, but by the same token, there is a greater responsibility in how we treat brothers and sisters in the Lord. Now, look at when the church in Jerusalem was under great persecution, and they losing their jobs, losing their homes and stuff. They bought, they sold, bought things, but it helped one another. But you notice, they didn't do that for non-Christians. That was only done for themselves. So I think that we need to understand that we have a higher responsibility that comes from how and what we do to those that are brothers and sisters in the Lord Christ.
That's often, especially in the times of
acts of faith.
John 13:35, you shall all men know that you are my disciples if you have love
one
to another.
Yeah, exactly. Well, not enough for me that you get on the air. Are you there? I guess she's not. What does Matthew chapter 10:37 mean? I'm not touching it over there, but Matthew 10:37. You love father and mother more than me, and not more than me. And he loves father and mother more than me, he's not more than me. Well, it goes back to what I said almost 2 hours ago. When you must not allow anyone, husband, wife, son, daughter, mother, father, brother, let's not allow anyone to come between us and our relationship with the Lord. What this is really speaking of is as the preeminent in our life. That's what it means. It's not meaning that I've got to take this world, I've got to do this for God. I don't care what condition my parents are in, you know, they need me, but I'm not, you know, that's not what that means. It just means in the heart. Bring that in your heart, so it's not taking it up. How would y'all comment on that?
I have to think that if it comes to your personal intimate relationship with Christ and a brother, or a brother, or a parent, or a sibling, you're either going to